Ready for a wonderful communion.
Amen. Hopefully you guys have been able to enjoy this amazing weather. It's warm, the sun is out. I know for me, I sure have. I'm actually a gardener, and last year was the first time that I started a garden from the ground up. I mean, it was nothing. I got the chance to build the boxes and cultivate the soil and just pour all these nutrients and love into it. And then I planted the seeds and I got to watch, and I bought some plants too, and I got to watch them grow and produce these fruits and vegetables. And then eventually they ended up on our table, and it was just such a rewarding feeling to be able to enjoy something that I poured so much love into and to be able to share it with others, with our loved ones. And then winter came, and obviously everything died. It was dry, it was brittle. I mean, this place that I once would escape to and I couldn't wait to get into now was just completely dead. So obviously I avoided it. I neglected it, and I just refused to go back into the garden because it was bad. Now, we can approach the different things in our lives in that same exact way. For many of us, we pour a lot of ourselves into things that end up consuming us so much that we find our identities and our purpose in whatever it is in our lives that we're pouring ourselves into. So then once those seasons end and that chapter closes in our lives, we find ourselves feeling dead. We find ourselves feeling this great sense of emptiness. It's almost like even a subtle feeling of failure because of that loss. And so, like myself, who refused to go into the garden, many of us choose not to take that step forward. Many of us choose to just remain stagnant, and we forget what it's like trusting in God when it comes to the next season that he's trying to bring us into. So fast forward to the spring. I was so excited to get back in there. I immediately cleaned up everything that was dead. You know, before it was bringing life, it was bringing so much to my life, but now it needed to be cleaned up. So I cleaned it up and I took the soil and I started to cultivate it again. I poured my love into it and brought water in there to bring in moisture. And before I planted anything, within about a week, seedlings started to come up. And I was just really overwhelmed by that moment. This garden that to me seemed dead, that didn't have life in it, all of a sudden had these seeds that were waiting for the right time to spring up. For many of us, we look at retirement. We might look at a dead marriage even. There might be moments where we just even have our children perhaps that are growing up and they're out of the house and now we're feeling like, okay, what do I do with my life? And so it was in this moment that I just saw something so beautiful. What is amazing about what Jesus did on that cross for us through his love and obedience, yes, was salvation, but he also gave us new hope. And when we look at that new hope, it's not just something that he gave us in that moment. It's something that he gives us in every single season of our lives. Now, 1 Peter 1:3 tells us, "Praise be to God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." So instead of us holding on to this hopelessness, let's shed it and let's choose to rejoice and to step into that new hope. 2 Corinthians says, "For all those that are in Christ Jesus, you are a new creature. The old has passed away, and behold, the new has come." So right now in this moment, while we are sitting here meditating, I really want you guys to ask God to show you the areas of your life that are dead and ask him to bring a newness and a new hope back in. And if there's a season in your life that he's closed the door, that has ended, ask him to open up your heart to where you are bold enough to proceed and trusting in him to take that step forward into whatever it is that God has for you next. So right now, while we take the elements and meditate, I'll go ahead and give us some time and then I'll come back for prayer. My God, I just want to thank you that you are giving us this moment, Father. I thank you, God, that what your son did on that cross was so powerful that it sits even in this moment. Father, I thank you because of your sovereignty. I thank you that even when our feet feel so heavy because of how empty we feel inside, that you can still pick us up as the master gardener and bring life and newness back into our lives where we just can't see it. Father, I thank you because in my today, that's all I see, Father, but you know our tomorrows. So God, we place them now in your hands. Lord, I pray for open hearts. I ask that you prepare our minds, God, and I just right now rejoice in what you are about to do for us, Father, as we continue in our journey. May we continue to delve deeper in you, God, in every season. We thank you for this new hope in Jesus Christ. In your mighty name we pray, amen.
As you guys finish up the elements, go ahead and stand and join with us in another time of worship. you guys so much for worshiping with us. Thank you online. You guys can go ahead and grab a seat and check out what's going on at Summit.
Hey, Summit, my name's Sam, and I'm one of the pastors here. Thank you so much for worshiping with us. If you're new, we would love it if you would text the number that's below. It just gives us an opportunity to connect with you, to get to know you, and to give you an opportunity to hear more about the church. As we look ahead, summer is finally here, and that means midweek hits the road for the best summer yet. We have an action-packed calendar for your students where they're gonna have an opportunity to experience God like never before, where they're gonna have an opportunity to build community in a Christ-centered environment, and where they can get the opportunity to make memories that are going to last a lifetime. Early bird registration is now open, so if you have a student who's completed fifth grade all the way up through 12th, we'd love for you to head over to our app to register today. And later this summer, for you adults, we have Men's and Women's Encounter. It's an opportunity to experience God in a way that you never have before. So head over to the app to get more information as well as to register yourself. This year in our student ministry has been one for the books, but despite all the changes, all the uncertainty, God continues to do what he always does. He's shown up and he's shown out. We've witnessed our students go from a posture of consumers to a posture of producers for the kingdom. Literally right now, at this moment, middle school and high school students are reaching and teaching the next generation. And that's a testament to your generosity. As you know, there's a number of ways to give at Summit. Again, we just want to say thank you. Thank you for your generosity that fuels the ministries where life change gets to happen. Now let's pray for Steve as he finishes up his last series here at Summit titled, Why? God, thank you so much for what you're doing in the midst of your church. Thank you for the countless number of years that we've had an opportunity to serve alongside Steve. I pray that you would anoint his words. I pray that the message that you've laid on his heart would penetrate our hearts. And not only would it penetrate our hearts, but it would be something that would transformationally change the way that we live our lives. God, we love you. We thank you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning, Summit family, both here on campus and online. It's great to see the room filling up more each weekend. It's awesome to have you here. And did you know Sam and Susanna had their little baby last week? That Hazel, mom and daughter are doing just fine, but pray for Sam and Susanna. They've got two little ones in the house now, and that can get a little bit crazy, so keep them in your prayers, all right? Well, this morning I'd like to share with you about a come-to-Jesus moment that I had in early January. This was several weeks before Pam and I decided to step away, and I had a fairly profound experience with God that deeply shaped me in some fresh ways. And he's laid on my heart that he would like me to share these things with you in these last 3 weeks as I finish out my last series at Summit. You see, as we rolled into January, in this moment of, well, frustration, fatigue, I wasn't really doubting God's existence or anything about my salvation, but I was just plain tired of giving. Now, I'm sure none of you have ever experienced that here at Summit. Quite sure of that. But I was, well, it was a real deep funk. And I was just plain tired of giving here at Summit. Now, I suppose there would be, you know, ample reason for that. Not that anybody else would experience these reasons, but you know, we have as a church been through 5 major generosity initiatives in the 23 years that I've served here. And whenever we've had one of these initiatives, Pam and I have tried to lead by example. So that means that in the last 23 years, 12 of those years, we have been stretching beyond giving above and beyond. And frankly, I was just tired. I looked ahead at what we still had committed with Unleashed, and I was not smiling from ear to ear. It felt like a chore, not a joy. Now, I am sure none of you have ever felt like that before, ever at all. I hope it doesn't surprise you that your pastor has emotional ups and downs. I hope it doesn't shock you that sometimes I'm not smiling from ear to ear when I'm thinking about giving. I'm a man. I've got feet of clay. I'm a broken, saved sinner, just like all of you. And so I hope you can identify with where I was, but mostly I hope you can identify with where God took me in that season. Because he showed me some things that were not new, but in a very deeply significant way, they were fresh to me, and they impacted me, and they energized me, and they mobilized me to make a commitment to remain generous to the cause of Christ till my last breath. And I hope that what God did in my life would challenge and motivate you to make that same kind of commitment. Now, some of you have been with us in these recent years, and you've been with us through three major generosity initiatives back to back to back. We had Cannonball, then we had Me to We, then we had Unleashed that we're now finishing and moving forward with, some of us. So I think many of us here on campus or online could probably identify with the kinds of things I was feeling. Frankly, I would be surprised, I would be shocked if there weren't conversations in all kinds of Summit families where people are talking, is this ever going to end? Are they always going to have another initiative? And so I think there's probably been a lot of conversations, always behind closed doors, maybe not in your house, but in the other person's house from Summit, okay? And so, again, I hope that what God has done in my life in this experience will resonate with you and you'll make the same kind of commitment. So I'm titling the series, Why? Why would I remain generous till my last breath? Why would I make that commitment to continue to give generously until I close my eyes and see Jesus face to face? And the first reason is that, very simply, I want to advance the cause of Christ. I want to advance the cause of Christ. Now, as I said a moment ago, none of this that I'm going to share is new to most of us online. But in a deeply significant, spiritually powerful way, it became new to me, and it remains new to me, and it's driven me to make some commitments to continue to be generous for the rest of my life. And before I unpack this first reason, I want to be generous to advance the cause of Christ, I've asked a new friend, Michael Jackson, to share with us in song, a song that I believe will set up everything that I'll share from this point on. So would you welcome Michael Jackson, please?
Glorious place.
Awesome, Michael. That was fantastic. Thank you. Thank you. Wasn't that amazing? Well, give it up for Michael one more time. Come on, that was awesome. That is the Michael Jackson. Now, I first heard that song when I was probably in sixth or seventh grade. And you need to understand this was a decade or more before I heard anything about Jesus, knew anything about Jesus. But when I heard that song, there was a spark that was planted in me to make a difference. I wanted to make a difference. I wanted the world to be a better place because I had walked on this planet. And I can't sing worth a hoot, okay? But I would go behind closed doors and I would belt out that I was going to march into hell for a heavenly cause. And there was something that birthed in me that I wanted to make a difference. And then when I became a Christ follower at 21 years of age, everything became clear. The reason that I existed became clear. And for the last now 46 years, Pam and I, we have given our lives to advance the cause of Christ. Our impossible dream has been to reach people and grow them up for Jesus. And that's taken us around the globe. First led us to Chile for 10 years, and then to Wisconsin, and now for the last nearly 23 years here in Wisconsin. Our dream has been to change the world for Jesus Christ. It's an impossible dream. In fact, so much so that when we first came to Northern Nevada, we would tell our family and friends that we were moving to Reno to start a new church. And we said, Reno was so close to hell that you could see sparks. And we've seen sparks. God has moved in some great ways. Well, God reminded me of that dream in early January. God reminded me that my childhood dream was to make a difference. He reminded me of my impossible dream. And he also reminded me that I'd given my whole life to do everything short of sinning to see people come to Jesus and grow up in Jesus. And then, not in an audible voice, but in a very clear sense, he whispered these words to me. He said, Steve, it takes money to advance the cause of Christ. That's why I want you to live generously for the rest of your life. Steve, it takes money to advance the cause of Christ. That's why I want you to be generous for the rest of your life. And I thought about that. And then I began to scroll in my mind through a whole array of scriptures that are found throughout the Bible. Exodus 36:6, when the Israelites brought such an abundance of offerings that they had to be restrained. And then Numbers chapter 7, when a massive ingathering of resources by God's people was put together. And then Numbers chapter 18, the first of many times when God says to his people, set aside the first 10% for ministry to fuel my purposes. And then 1 Chronicles 29, when David and a whole bunch of his leaders gathered a mountain of resources so Solomon could build the temple. And then Matthew chapter 6 and verse 21, when Jesus is speaking about laying up treasures in heaven, not on earth. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 16, when the church is taught, our church is taught, all churches around the globe that are Bible churches are taught to set aside resources in a systematic and consistent way so that ministry can be fueled. And then 2 Corinthians chapter 8 and 9, two full chapters on generosity. And all of these scriptures were washing through my mind. And a clear principle coalesced, not new, certainly, but new to me, fresh to me, fresh language to me, maybe fresh to you. And this is the principle. Advancing the cause of Christ is always fueled by resources given by God's people. to advance God's purposes, his impossible dream of reaching this world for Jesus is always fueled by resources given by God's people. Now, there are a few exceptions. Thought of these last night. Manna from heaven. You know, that was an exception. God just gave the manna. Elisha, there was a widow that God provided oil that she could sell, miraculously provided oil that she could sell and find her provision. So there are a few isolated examples of God plopping down money or resources. But most of the time, if you look at the sweep of Scripture from Genesis right to the end of the Bible, advancing God's purposes is always fueled by resources given by God's people. And that was a new, fresh principle for me in early January. Now, God did not have to do it that way, friends. He could have provided for his ministry. It's his ministry, not mine, not yours. He could have provided it in other ways. For example, he could have determined that if we are a sincere believer in Jesus and we genuinely want to advance his purposes, well, all we have to do is pray and the money would just show up in a bank account. He could have done it that way. He's God. He can do anything that he wants. But he didn't do it that way. All through the Bible, we see him providing resources for his mission. Again, it's his mission, his church. He provides through the giving of his people. Now, when I was discouraged in early January, because of giving and giving and giving, that was the first reason that got me back on track, got my mind and heart in the right place. Generosity is part of fulfilling the impossible dream that God birthed in my heart as a child. Now, I hope that you want your life to make a difference too. I hope that you don't just want to take up space on this planet for a few years, live a nice life, and then die. I hope that you want to live out an impossible dream too. That you want your life to make a difference for Jesus. And if you do, I hope that you'll join me in reaffirming or making a commitment that as God would enable, you would live generously until your last breath. That's my commitment, and I hope it's yours as well. Because I don't want to just spin my wheels and have a good life and accumulate some things and die with nobody having been changed because of my life. And I don't think that you want your life to be that empty as well. Now, something that's been very helpful for me in this whole process of thinking about generosity is making it clear who I'm giving to. Now, it might surprise you that I do not normally say that I am giving to Summit. I don't say that because I'm not, in the first instance, giving to Summit. I'm giving to God through Summit's ministry. And I think that's not just semantics. I think this is a very important thing to keep clear. So I generally say it like this. I give to advance the cause of Christ through Summit's ministry. I give to advance the cause of Christ through Summit's ministry. More than just semantics, this keeps the lines of accountability very clear. My responsibility for God, my privilege before God, is to give generously. The church's responsibility before God is to spend wisely. The church will be held accountable for how wisely they spend the money. I will be held accountable by God for how generously that I give. Now, this is a, you know, generosity is kind of a funny wiggle word, isn't it? What does it mean to be generous? What does it mean to be generous? You know, everybody has a different idea about what it means to be generous. We all manage different levels of resources. So what may be generous for one person, well, it's not generous at all for another. So how would you define what is generous? How would you frame that? If you consider yourself a generous person online, I want you to think about this too. If you consider yourself a generous person, what are your benchmarks? How do you evaluate that? How do you measure that? Well, I've thought about this some, and I've found three levels of generosity that are helpful benchmarks, helpful measuring points. I'd like to share them with you. The first level of generosity is what I call purposeful giving, okay? Purposeful giving is giving a predetermined amount every paycheck. So you determine you're going to give an X every paycheck. Now, some of us may be in the situation, like most Americans, that every paycheck that comes, it gets spent before the end of the month or right close to the end of the month. Sometimes you're waiting for that month to, you know, end quicker, and you spend it all, 100%. Now, you might not know exactly where it's all going, but it's all gone. And when I'm talking about investing in the cause of Christ, you think to yourself, oh, Steve, you're a Lulu. That won't work. I can't make it hardly to the end of the month as it is. And you're thinking that I might give something to the cause of Christ? Well, that's where this purposeful giving plays a part. Because you can set aside a specific amount, and it will get you moving in the generosity journey. And it is a journey. We're all on a journey, okay? And this will get you moving in that direction. Now, usually, if I was sitting with you at Starbucks or at Lighthouse Coffee, and we're having a conversation, and you say, Steve, my finances are tighter than a drum. I don't have anything I can give to the cause of Christ. If I was looking at you and that's your situation, I would say to you, well, why don't you start with $100 a pay period? Just $100 a pay period. Now, that's a measurable amount. It's a purposeful amount. And the reason that I suggest that is because for most of us, some of us may be an exception, but for most of us, we're not wandering around with an extra $100 bill in our pocket, okay? So it's not extra. We have to think about it. We have to plan for it. It's not we come to church and whatever's in our pocket, we drop in the generosity boxes. No, it's a measurable amount. Now, most people, or many people in the United States, are really struggling with unwise debt. That may describe you. If that describes you, I want to strongly encourage you to consider taking Financial Peace University, because that's a tool that God has provided that's helped so many people get their finances in order. Well, anyway, the Federal Reserve recently published a statistic that the average household in America is now $6,270 in credit card debt. Now, I don't think that describes anybody at Summit. We're an exceptional church. I'm sure nobody is in that category. I'm just pulling your leg. I imagine there's many of us in that category, okay? And because of that, we start at the beginning of the month and we're already behind the eight ball because we have this credit card debt that we're paying. We don't remember what it was for, but somewhere in the past, we put something on the card and now we're paying on it. And so from the beginning of the month to the end of the month, we're really, really tight. Well, if that describes you, this is where purposeful giving can be very helpful. So yes, you have to be responsible about your debts and other obligations. Of course. But before you do anything else, set aside $100 a month, $100 a paycheck. And that way you can begin the generosity journey and start in that direction. Second, percentage giving is giving 10% from all your streams of income. 10% from all your streams of income. This is sometimes called tithing. The word tithe means 10%. Now, I personally don't like to use the word tithing for a couple of reasons. First of all, some people use the word for giving to church. So they may be giving $10 a pay period to church, and they call it tithing. Well, newsflash, spoiler alert, tithing is only if you're giving 10%. But sometimes people misuse that word. They say, well, I'm tithing to church, and I'm giving, you know, a modest amount, but it's... So I don't like to use it for that reason, and I don't like to use it also because it's an old word. How often have you used that word outside of church? You know, go to your grocery store, hey, ma'am, are you tithing? Nobody uses that word. Tithe, it's an old word. So I don't find it very helpful because it's an old word and it's misunderstood. So I find it more helpful to talk about percentage giving. Percentage is an easily understood concept, and it's far more clear. Now, the standard of giving 10% back to the kingdom of God is woven all through the Bible. It goes a long time before the Jewish law was codified under Moses. Abraham, for example, way before Moses, was bringing back the spoils of a battle, and he gives 10% to a mysterious Old Testament priest named Melchizedek. So that happened way before the Jewish law was codified, and then it's woven all through the Old Testament. And one of my favorite verses is Malachi chapter 3 and verse 10. bring the whole tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house. Only time in the Bible where God says, test him. He says then that there may be food in my house. Test me in this, says the Lord Almighty. See if I will not throw open the floodgates of heaven and pour out so much blessing there will not be enough room to store it. I love that verse. That's a verse that I've committed memory, and I believe it is true. It's one of many verses in the Old Testament that talk specifically about tithing, but the New Testament also affirms this standard of 10%. I think that might surprise some of the Bible scholars here in this room. You're thinking, oh, Steve, that's an Old Testament deal. It's not New Testament. Well, guess what? Every time Jesus reinterpreted the Old Testament law, he never lowered the standard. He always raised the standard. So, for example, when Jesus talks about now it's not just adultery that's prohibited, he says now we should not even look lustfully at another woman. So the standard from the Old Testament went from adultery to lustfully looking at someone else. The standard is raised. In the Old Testament, it says we're prohibited from murdering, from killing wantonly. And now in the New Testament, Jesus says now we shouldn't even be angry unduly. So the standard is raised in the New Testament with Jesus. And so I ask you, if Jesus is raising the standard all around the block, why wouldn't it apply to generosity as well? So I have an old-fashioned green ledger book that I use to work my finances. You might use QuickBooks. You might use something fancy on your phone. I've tried. I just can't quite get used to it. So I use an old-fashioned green ledger book when I work my finances. I have for years. In fact, part of clearing things out to go to Costa Rica, I had to deep six ledger books from like 20 years ago. It broke my heart. I had them all. I mean, I have watched every penny for all 44 years we've been married. And deep six that, not going to carry that with me anymore. Anyway, however you do it, however you manage your resources, again, I use an old-fashioned green ledger book. What I do is I put giving to the cause of Christ on the top line. It's just a practical, physical way to evidence that I'm giving to the cause of Christ as my first priority. Before I save, before I pay the rest of my bills, I put it on that top line. And for as long as I can remember as a Christ follower, I've done that. Now, if you've never been a percentage giver, and you're going to begin today online, listen carefully, you're going to begin today by being a purposeful giver. Praise God. You're taking a step forward in the generosity journey. Begin moving step by step to become a percentage giver. You start as a purposeful giver, then move to be a percentage giver. And one day you might come to me, I hope you will, send me an email in Costa Rica, Steve, I've started to give 10%. Don't call yourself a tither. You can do that. Call yourself a percentage giver. Then I'll know you've listened to the message and you're catching on, okay? So anytime we begin giving 10% of our resources, that means we've become a percentage giver. And the third level of generosity is what I call progressive giving. This is giving more than 10%. And sometimes we call this over and above giving. And I have to tell you, if the biblical standard is 10% and anything above that is called progressive giving, you guys as a church family have absolutely been rocking it as a church. Unbelievable. Hundreds of families have been doing that for the last several years here at Summit. And your progressive giving has allowed us to be building that new worship center next door. Unleashed has been the most generous financial initiative in a church in Northern Nevada history. No other church has come close to the level of generosity of this church in the last 2.5 years. Absolutely amazing. More than $8.6 million had been given, and more is coming in every week. I can't tell you how proud I am of our Summit family. And that's allowing us to build that new 1,300-seat auditorium that's being built so we can reach all the people that are moving into the valley and more. And so I thought it would be kind of fun for Pam and I to give you a little guided tour of that new facility. Would you like that? Watch the screens. We're going to give you a guided tour.
Hi, everybody. Here we are in the new building, and I want you to know it is just awesome all that they've gotten done so far.
It is amazing. We're standing on the stage right now, and it is an enormous stage. I can't imagine the power from the Word of God that's going to come off this stage and how fun it's going to be to preach about Jesus and worship Jesus from this stage.
Well, here we are in the baptistry, and this is huge. I can't believe it. It's big enough to do a whole family all at once.
Matter of fact, I think, Pam, that I could actually swim laps in here. Don't have to go to Alf Sorensen anymore. We could just go back and forth. And what's really amazing is to think about all the people in the next decades that are going to begin their spiritual journey by being baptized here. It's going to be amazing. This place is going to be just filled with people falling in love with Jesus.
It's pretty cool. So here we are backstage. This is really cool. In fact, this is the area where people are going to be preparing for baptism. Those of you that have been baptized over in the other building know what it's like to have to go out in your bathing suit, down the hall, across the lobby, upstairs to change your clothes. Well, now they'll be able to change here and be prayed for. It'll be a private area. It's just going to be awesome.
And once again, amazing to think of the life change that's going to happen in these places where we are right now. And the metal studs are going in. They'll be all drywalled. And that's going to eventually cover up all of the scriptures. Some of the scriptures are still visible. Many of the others have already been covered up with insulation. And slowly it's beginning to seal up. It's an amazing thing. And being backstage is, like Pam said, it's just amazing to see what's going to happen in this place. Here we are where the stadium seats are going to be, Pam, and it's pretty amazing. They're going to fan up, and this bowl has been designed so every seat has a clear line of sight to the stage, and it's been intentionally designed so everybody will feel intimate and close to each other. Although there's 1,300 seats in this room, Pam, everybody's going to feel like they're still very much a part of the Summit family. We really wanted to have that connectivity continue in this building. It's going to be amazing.
Yeah. And you imagine the people that are going to be sitting right here where we're standing, and they're going to be hearing the Word of God, and they're going to be worshiping, praising God together, some for the first time walking into a church building and saying, wow, I never thought church could be like this. It's going to be great.
Going to be great. And again, all because of the incredible generosity, lavish generosity of our church family to allow more people to hear Jesus, about Jesus, and to fall in love with him.
Now, this is the area that I am so excited about. This is the cafe, and it's going to be open all week long, and the community can come in and have this wonderful coffee and fellowship, and it's just going to be a beautiful place where people are going to want to come and gather together.
Yeah, and it's not just for the church family. On the weekends, we'll enjoy it, but during the week, we're really hopeful that this would be an avenue for people that are not even seeking God at this point, but they would come because the environment is beautiful, the environment is pleasant, there's good Wi-Fi, good coffee, and along the way, they'll discover that there's a place here that loves Jesus, and it would hopefully be a doorway so people can get to know Jesus. Again, we're doing all this to reach more people for Jesus, and all possible because of the amazing generosity of our church family.
And you know, you can see the whole valley. This is just amazing up here.
Hey, now we're in the new lobby, and I want you to know these exposed beams, they just started getting put in this last week. They're beautiful. This space is going to be just spectacular. Lots of glass along the front, and here's where people are, before and after church, are going to be gathering, talking, sharing life. It's just going to be amazing, Pam.
Isn't that cool? Give it up for the Lord on that one, huh? That's amazing. Friends, and that new facility is going to be a legacy, a spiritual legacy that will continue in this valley for decades to come. And I hasten to point out, friends, that in future years, there will be thousands of people that will become a part of the Summit Church family. But our generation, this generation, we're the ones with the privilege, and I count it a great privilege, to have sacrificed to allow that facility to become a reality. And your spiritual legacy will endure for decades and decades as we've all given to allow that building to be built. I said earlier, friends, that advancing the cause of Christ is always fueled by resources given by God's people. We see that all through Scripture. We've seen it all through church history. We've seen it here in Summit over these last nearly now 23 years. Not long ago, I counted up all of the messages on stewardship, on generosity that I have taught over these last now nearly 23 years. Nearly 100. 100 messages, nearly, over these last nearly 23 years. I've taught more about generosity than any other single topic. It's not always made me popular by a long shot, but it's been more than worth it. I say that because over the years, our congregation, you, have learned to be generous to the cause of Christ on a spectacular scale. Experts that have looked in at the level of generosity of our church are amazed. It's not a stretch to say that Summit is now one of the most generous congregations on the West Coast. I would say in the United States, but I don't have enough information. I know on the West Coast. That is a source of great, appropriate pride and giving it honor and glory to Jesus. And it's because so many of us have learned that this life is not all there is, and we want to advance the cause of Christ. In just a few weeks, Pam and I will step away from the ministry here, and it's bittersweet. We love our church family, no question. But one of the things that gives us great ongoing joy is knowing that the generosity of this church will continue for decades to come. And it might be a little silly in a way, but I think it all started in a sixth or seventh grade boy who heard a song about marching into hell for a heavenly cause. I wanted to make a difference. I wanted my life to count. I wanted this world to be a better place because I had walked on this planet. And then when I became a Christ follower, it all became clear. The mission, the impossible dream that God wants me and all of us to be engaged with is advancing His purposes, reaching people, growing them up in Jesus. And so resources is a huge part of that. That's why I've given generously throughout my faith journey. And that's why after I had my come to Jesus moment in early January, I looked at the sky and I said, Jesus, I'm going to remain generous till my last breath. For the last many years of my father-in-law's life, I did his taxes. Some of you will remember Dave Snow. Dave and Carolyn were a very important part of this church for a number of years. I did his taxes, and while they were on a fairly modest fixed income for those many years, I saw the percentage that they gave to the cause of Christ, and it was exemplary, way above 10%. That was an example that spoke to me. That's the kind of example that I want to follow. I want your life too to count for beyond what we are here, to make a difference for the cause of Christ. So I hope and pray you will be motivated and challenged and inspired, that with your last breath you will continue to be as generous as God calls you to, and that it would be said of you that you lived out an impossible dream, that you marched into hell for a heavenly cause, you did something for Jesus that reverberates beyond your grave into the lives of people that have been touched because your generosity made a difference. We might not all be able to serve in children's ministry. I know our children's team would love it if you would. We might not all be able to serve in student ministry. We might not all be able to show up on Friday nights for Celebrate Recovery. Very few of us are going to be able to participate actively in the local ministry partners that we help, Teen Challenge and many others in our community. Very few of us will be able to go around the globe with our global mission partners, but all of us are a part of that. As we fuel the purposes of Christ, as we mobilize what God entrusts to us to give to the cause of Christ so that the world will be different because we have walked on planet Earth. Would it be said of Summit that we lived out an impossible dream, that we lived beyond ourselves, and that the world is a better place, a more Christ-honoring place, because we've chosen to be generous. Would to God that that would be our legacy, not only here, but wherever God takes us. Now, I can't finish up these last 3 weeks without making sure that every single one of us has an opportunity to cross that line of faith. You may be a guest here today online. You may be a guest just tuning in. We're all about Jesus here. We want people to make decisions for Jesus and then walk in fullness with Jesus. And if you've never made a decision, I don't know all of you in this room. I don't know everyone online by a long shot. But if you've never made a decision in favor of Jesus, would you do that today? Would you begin the journey today? Would you cross that line of faith? I'm going to provide an opportunity for you to do that. Would you all please bow your heads briefly and close your eyes? If you decide to follow Jesus now, you want to make that decision, pray along with me something like this. Jesus, I want to thank you for your amazing love and grace. Thank you for dying for me on the cross. And as best I can in this moment, Jesus, I give you complete authority in my life. I surrender my life to you. I want you to be my King and my Lord. I want to live for you. I take the hands off the steering wheel. Jesus, I give you control. You are Lord of my life now, as best I can in this moment. Thank you for changing me now. Help me to not live in my own ways and my own strength. Help me, Jesus, to live for you as my Lord and as my King. And I want to thank you for that. In Jesus' name, amen. If you made that decision, we've got kind of a little funky way we do it around here, okay? We're asking you to text Jesus to the number on the screen. Online, you can do that, but I'm old school, guys. I've been vaccinated, okay? If you made a decision, you're on campus, you come up and give me a hug, okay? I like hugs. If you don't want a hug, I'll shake your hand, all right? The point is, come and talk to me, all right? Otherwise, you have a blessed week. Let's live for Jesus. Live that impossible dream. Let's make a difference for the cause of Christ. God bless you. See you next week.